First about me, I'm Michael, or people call me Schnitzel. I work at the Macy Labs. We have offices in Zurich and Austin. We are 25 people, so we're like the Drupal-only shop, and we build a lot of multilingual. So maybe a little game. What do you think? I will show you some sites, and tell me, what do you think? What do have all these websites in common? Any clues already? They're not English, not only. That one is English, for example, but it's the official website of France. A game site. What? They're multilingual, correct? A train company, Estee Lauder, a cake company, another gaming company, Pinterest, business website, Nokia. No clue yet? They're all built in Drupal. What a surprise, but they're all built in Drupal multilingual. So they are all sites built in Drupal 7. Some of them are now moving to 8 in multilingual. And you can see, if you think about it, it's really crazy what we have to build. There are so many different languages all over the world, and there are like websites that have to do like so much different things and so many different clients, and they all run on Drupal. And if you have contributed to multilingual, they run your code. Like if you name even rest sites that are right to left, so it's pretty crazy and pretty staggering to see what type of different websites there are. So the list does never end. The problem is with multilingual. Usually, when somebody comes to you and says, like, hey, I need that really complex page architecture that we just saw, then you go to Drupal.org and see you found the paragraphs module. So you say, there is a module for that. With multilingual, unfortunately, it's not that easy. So the problem is, if you go to Drupal.org and you enter internationalization or multilingual, you have like a module and you install it, and that's what it will. You will install it and you realize it's actually not that fun as you thought. So we had that a lot. Like my first initial, when I did like the first multilingual sites 5 years ago, that was what happened. Like you install multilingual and it's done. It's not. And why do we do that? That's Switzerland. And yes, we are super, super tiny. There are only 8 million people there, but we have 4 official languages. And English is actually none of them, so we have 5. So every website we build is at least 2 languages, sometimes 4, sometimes 5, and sometimes even crazier. So that is one client that we've built that has 12 different countries, which have, again, different languages. So that's how the language list looks inside of Drupal, because you also have language fallbacks that we'll see later. So we do a lot of Drupal, and we do a lot of multilingual. If you start to do Drupal, especially right now, there is one really important decision that you have to take, and that is between entity translation or content translation, because they don't really like each other. They're fundamentally different, and I want to explain you first what are the differences, because whatever I'm going to tell you afterwards, it's based on that. So we use completely entity translation only. Why? First, it allows you things that are not possible with content translation. Pretty easy. Second is, entity translation is the default in Drupal 8. So whatever we build now, we'll build it in a way that in the future, we don't know when, but at one point we probably will upgrade that to Drupal 8, it should be easier. So we build things already with Drupal 8 way that is entity translations. Entity translation uses field translations, which already exists in Drupal 7. That's why we can use it. It's just not widely known that it actually existed. And it means you have only one single node for all languages. That's sometimes really confusing. That's sometimes really cool, especially if you talk in e-commerce. They will like that, because if you have a German blue t-shirt and an English blue t-shirt, and you want to know how many blue t-shirts you sold, you have to combine numbers because they're different nodes with content translation, and that's sometimes really hard. How do we use entity translation? So here Drupal comes a bit in his specialties because there is no button that says entity translation. So basically, if you go on a content type, you can enable that per content type. You can say, if you go to enabled with translation, that is called content translation. If you go to enabled with field translation, that is called entity translation. So it's a bit confusing, but when you understand that, that's the first thing. So let's look at the difference. Let's say we have a node, that's node number one, and we use content translation. It has a language key, we need to know which language it is, and we have a title, and we tell that the title of the node one is welcome. And then you have a body, that is called body itself, so you fill it with body. It has a UND, we ignore that for now, and the value, and then you have an image that has a reference to a file ID, that is 45 here. And we have a TNID, which we'll see what happens, because we have a second node, the node number two, so it's a completely separate node, that has language DE, title willkommen, which is welcome in German, the body is written Körper, also German, the image points to the same image, because let's say it's a picture of a human, so we have the human picture. But now we have the TNID, and the TNID of the node number two points to node number one, which basically tells Drupal that these are the translations of each other. So if you have a language dropdown on the node number two, it can show you the language for English, it can directly link you to the English. Or if you visit the page without the language and the language negotiation comes in and all that stuff happens, it knows to which node. So that's the to tell Drupal how that works, it's a TNID. On the other side, on entity translation, it works completely different. We have only one node. It also has a language code, and that is the language code of the first language you create the node. So it doesn't, it's not an array or anything. It's just the language of the first it's the language code of the first language of that node, which can be a bit confusing in the future. We'll see that. We also have a title. Then we have a body, the EN and TE, and now you see here the differences. So now the UND, which means undefined language, and not UND in German, it's actually written in there, and we have the body and the Körper. The image, which we did not select to be translatable, we'll see that. We say it's also 45, and that is actually the, so the entity translation happens there. That's the magic of entity translation. So, looks all great, right? There's one really big issue. Whose is it? The title. Yes, the title is not translated. Yeah. So if you look into the past of Drupal 7, there was a node that said convert node title to fields. And we did that. It was committed. Everybody was happy. All the multilingual people said, yes, we also have a title to translate because you cannot live with a title. The problem was, though, that like a couple of months later, we removed that again. Why? It got super slow, basically. Drupal 7 was not able to handle that. The title was so used in so many places that having a field there with loading all the field stuff, just like basically it made Drupal 7 even slower than it was. So yes, we reverted that whole thing again, and we were back in having a title as we know it. Happily, there is a module for that. It's called title. What a surprise. And it basically replaces you the title with the title field. It will still keep the title as a normal element of the node, but it will automatically load you the right one that you need and all that stuff. So it's not the perfect solution, but it works, and it's pretty great. And it also works not only for nodes, it also works for term names and product names and all these things that have a title or a something like that. So we do that, and yeah, I said that's the main thing. And you see here that you can actually define which fields of an entity or of a content type should be translatable or not. And that happens on the setting of the field. So when you edit the field, there is a checkbox that says user may translate all occurrences of this field, which tells that you can enable that. There's one important thing that says on top, even though you've added a field only for a content type, It means that these settings apply to the text field everywhere it is used. So if you have a field that you would like to be translated on one content type, and the same field on another that should not be translated, that does not work. If you enable it, it will be enabled for all of them. Drupal tries to handle it for you, that if you have no translation, it will still load another translation that not exists, but I suggest to really think about what do you really want to need to translate. So that means you have to study. You have to take your Drupal site and think about which fields do I need to make translatable. Maybe not military stuff, but yeah. So basically, what do we need to make translatable? There has to be some rule of thumb. So basically, everything with a text inside that is text you want to translate. So every text field you enable to be translatable. It's pretty obvious. But there are other things. Because sometimes we use languages not only to use different translations, like I do a German to English translation or whatever. Sometimes we use it for different information, and we have that a lot. So let's say you have a product. So we build a website for a medical company, and they are in the US and in the UK. It's both times English. And yes, there is some differences in their language, but they actually have to write different names for specific products. Like, by law, medical stuff is different in there. So they have to change some stuff. It's both times written in English. They have to write it different. Sometimes you have in the same company, you have different departments, and they want to call stuff different. It's still German, but they want to call it different a bit. So that ends up in actually being quite complex of doing different things, but we can use languages for that. So we have different locations and other stuff. So you have to understand that it's not only language. Sometimes you also need want to translate stuff just for the sake of showing something different in a different country or so. The hardest part that was for me to understand about entity translation was entity reference fields. So basically, no, you don't want to enable an entity reference field to be translatable, because the referenced entity will be translated again. So the field itself points to the same node, and because you have only one node all the time, you never do translate. One important thing is, in Drupal 7, you have a lot of different referencing fields right now. So there is user reference and there is node reference. I strongly suggest to only use entity reference. Why? Because it's in Drupal core, in Drupal 8 core anyway, and it just has the best support overall. So if you build a new Drupal 7 site, use entity reference than the other two. So let's look how it actually works. So we have our node back, and we now have a new field that is called field day. And you see here that it's UND, so it's not translatable, and the target ID is 98. So my node 1 points to node 98. Node 1 is translatable with body and körper. And now on node 98, I have my value Monday and Montag. So the text that is shown, let's say you show the field or the value of body inside the node 1 because of the entity reference, it's all fine. If we now would enable translation for that reference, so that happens in field day, what could happen is that in English and in German, you have different pointers, which is most probably not what you want. So we have a node 99 that has Monday and node 100 that is Tuesday. So based on the node, the language I am on node 1, it shows me different informations, not just translated. And that can happen if you make that translatable. So it's really important that you think about what to do, and usually know the entity reference. And we actually had that people like have to change. First it's both pointed to Monday, and then the German editor goes in and changes just the German version, and suddenly the information is wrong and everybody freaks out. So try to prevent that. Image fields. Do we translate image fields? No, unless you need different images. Again, if you have a different image for different languages, or the image has text inside. So if you have all these meme pictures, whatever, and they actually are translated, maybe you need to, but usually a picture has no text inside. And actually, all of them, the title text, are translatable itself. So there are fields again, so it's no problem. File fields in general, it's basically the same as the image. So if the file contains text, then probably yes. But if it's just like a, whatever, some data or whatever that has no text inside, you don't need to make translatable. List fields. So we have a predefined list that the content creator can select from. You don't want to translate that, because what could happen again is that the German and the English can select different ones. What you actually want to translate is just the option inside of the dropdown. And there, you use IATN field translations. So IATN field translations allows you to translate only the option. It will still be saved in the main language or the default language in the database, but it will just translate them every time you look at them. It will load the translation for that version. So it's, you don't actually translate it. Taxonomy fields, it's like entity reference. Most probably you also want to translate the taxonomy again, so you don't do translation of taxonomy fields, because the translated term is translated again. So yes, so we're happy. The problem is we only talked about nodes now. There is a lot more. There are other entities. So let's look at them. File entities. If you use the file entity module, it actually makes a file a full entity. So it has fields again and all that stuff. So then the title and the alt texts are fields themselves. They can be translated again. We're all happy. So you have to make them translatable. And the file itself is not translatable. You cannot select the file to be translatable, because at one point you just have to stop. So if you need a file that has different, I don't know, different texts or so, you have to upload another file. At one point it's just over to make things translatable. Taxonomy entity translation. So there is also, because taxonomy entities are entities, it can be handled by the entity translation. But there's another module that is called IATN taxonomy that uses like the IATN string system to translate taxonomies. So we have two different systems that can provide you translations for taxonomy. We choose completely entity translation just because we use the exact same concept as with nodes. You also use for entities, which makes it much easier to understand for people that work on. And you have language fallbacks, which we'll see later a bit what is really great about them. So let's say you have a site right now that is content translation, and you decide you want to go to entity translation because you really like the systems, or you need new features, or you prepare for Drupal 8 upgrades, or whatever. There is a module that can help you do that. So you can upgrade inside Drupal 7 from content translation to entity translation. And I want to shortly show you what you have to look at, because you can break your site. So it's really important that you do these steps in this row, because if you do them in another row, you can easily break your site. So the first thing is you need the entity translation upgrade module, which is part of entity translation anyway. The first step you do a backup. You save that backup in one place. You do another backup. You save that backup in another place, and you do a third backup. And you never blame me that I destroyed your site, because I lost content without doing backups. So please do backups. Yeah, okay, no, the real order is you do first a backup. You make one that's important. The second is you make all fields translatable that need to be translatable. So you study whatever do I need to do, and then you replace the title with the title field. Not forget that, because if you do that, then you have data lost. And then you run the upgrade. And what will happen is basically entity translation upgrade will find the translations of content translation, like the groups that we saw connected with TNID before. It will choose the main language first, and it will copy over all the translations of the other nodes into the fields of the main node. And that's why it is so important that you make the fields translatable, because it will only do that for the fields that are marked as translatable. If you forgot a field, it will not copy the data over, and then you're in a state that you didn't want to. So you actually have to reroll your backup and start from scratch. The other nodes will be unpublished. So the data is not actually lost, it's just like not in a system that you can copy it over really easily. So if you need to find the data of the old nodes, they are still there. But if you did not make it translatable, you probably now copy-paste a lot of stuff by hand, which we all don't like. So make it in that order, think about, and then it actually works pretty well. We migrated sites with 35,000 nodes from counter translation to entity translation. We did it like 7 times because we forgot fields over and over, and you just try out, but it works at the end, and it's really great, and you can use all the new systems on your own Drupal 7 site without rebuilding it. So let's say you want to have more translations, because we don't only have node and taxonomy terms and files, we have a lot more. So how do we translate that? One thing that a lot of people use are field collection. The problem is they don't really work together with entity translation right now. There is a patch in the work since a long time, and it's just a bit stuck because nobody really took care of it. So it works kinda-ish, but not. So what we used instead is an inline entity form, because inline entity form uses entity reference, and entity reference works pretty well. There, it's a better widget. You can there is also a patch that makes it even easier. But that patch actually works much better than the field collection patch. So it's no perfect solution, but it's a much better one. Yes, you can also use paragraphs that we heard before. Paragraphs also use entities, so it's much better and works. Menus. There are 3 different ways how you can translate menus. And the problem is there is not one of them is the perfect solution. It really depends what you really need to get what you want. So first, the version A is you can create language-specific menus. So if your client tells you, my Spanish menu and my English menu and my German menu have to be completely different. Let's say they translate the whole website in English, and the German has maybe only like 3 of the 10 menu entries. So that means they are completely different. That's when it makes sense to have language-specific menus. Sometimes you only want to have language-specific menu items. So you have one menu for all languages, and you just give the menu items, you give them languages. So if like 90% is the same and only some of them different a bit, you can give the menu items languages and they will be only shown when the user is on that specific language. So it's another way to do things. And the last one, you can actually translate the menu titles. So you have one menu entry, it has no language, but then you can translate just the menu title, so you can translate home to like Startseite in German. So it really depends, and the configuration of these three is not that easy, we're gonna look at that. And yes, we feel sometimes like grumpy cat of saying like, what the hell, but we used all 3 systems with clients, so at the end, they are confusing, but there is reasons why they are there, and they're still there in Drupal 8, by the way. So if you edit a menu, you can choose between the menu has a fixed language, that's the lower one, that's the version A, so that menu itself has a fixed language and will only be shown when the user is on that language. And the upper two is translate and localize, so it already says there's 2. So these are is if you even want to have a language-specific item or you want to translate the menu title. So based on that, you want to select the upper one. So you have to choose between first these 2. And then when you are on a specific menu item, based on the language you give that menu item, you choose between the 2 versions. So if you give it a specifically language, you say that menu item is like English and it will be only shown if you are on the English side. If you want to show the same menu also on German, you have to create a second menu item and define it German. If you want to show it on all languages and just translate the title of it, you select the first one, you leave it language neutral, and then there is a translate tab where you can translate it and you can actually give it another title, but you cannot change the destination, for example, of the menu. Item. So it's a bit confusing, but that's how it works, and you have to really think of the things. And you can actually create combinations that do not work, Like in you can create a menu specific language, a menu specific for German, and the menu items in there you can create in English. And if you visit the page in German, it's completely empty because the menu is loaded, but the items are not, so it's a bit confusing, yeah. Views. So with entity translation, each translation has a published state and a language state. So you can, even though it's only one node and you have two languages, you can unpublish one of the languages, and views can use that. And you need to load that with a reference that we'll see later. So here, that's the view as we usually use it for content translation. So you just make a filter that you say, show me all nodes that are in the current user's language. If you remember what I showed you in the beginning, we saw a node, it had a lang code at the top. Even though we had two translations in there, we had the lang code in there, and that is what is used here. So if you want to do that for entity translation, if you do that, even though you have translations, because the lang code is only once there, it will not show you anything. So you have to load the information of the translation. So you basically create a relationship on the right here. So you load the information of the entity translation into the view. And then on the left side of the filter criteria, we can now filter on the language of the translation. So that's one important thing. If you switch from content translation to entity translation, you have to migrate all your views. Because if you don't do that, it will not show you anything, or it will only show you them in one language and not in the other. We made that much easier in Drupal 8, luckily. It's not that crazy. But if after you've done that one, two times, it's actually pretty easy. So it's really cool. Another interesting problem that we have is you need to translate to English a lot. We had the problem that the client didn't like the English that Drupal provided. And the client comes to you and says, like, can I please translate the login to sign in? Pretty common problem. Nobody? So we have that a lot, because people don't really like the English that is provided by Drupal. So, and the problem is that the original English language that is there when you install Drupal, it is used for the T function. So everything that is pointed in, is put by programmers into the T function is automatically assigned to English. And you cannot change that unless you actually change the code, but we don't want to do that. So what we do is we create a second English. We disable the original English, so you basically translate from English to English, which works. It's pretty cool. And so if you need a change, if the user doesn't like the login, which is the original English, you just translated it on the second English, so you can change your login to sign in or whatever. So that's how it looks. So we use the original EN. We give it the name Drupal English. You can change that so that everybody knows that's the Drupal English. And it's not enabled, and it's not, well, it's not the default. It's also not enabled. You cannot remove it because it's fixed in Drupal core 7. But then we have another English that has the code ENUS. Doesn't really matter what it has. And you just put that as a default. So every T function will automatically go into Drupal English, and then you can translate it again in English. It's a bit crazy, and it's fixed in 8 as well, but yeah, that's how it is. Yes, there is one other thing, is with IATN, if you use the IATN, there it's not automatically put into the original English, as it happens with T functions, so you can configure it. So you can configure, you can say which language should Drupal assume what the user or what the site builder enters. What we do, we also use Drupal English because then it works the same in T functions and in strings. It's just the same everywhere, and people are not confused. Why do I have that language now or not? Yes, web forms. There's two possibilities. Either you just create a separate web form per language, because maybe you need different selections or need different components, or you can create one web form for all languages, and you can use web form localization, which is a module that allows you to translate the different titles or the components elements. So that works pretty well. Search API, if you search API with entity translation, search API itself is a bit confused about it because it doesn't realize that there are multiple languages. With search API ET, or entity translation, it will basically teach search API that there are multiple languages, and it will do everything that is necessary to do that. And then, of course, we have a lot of other stuff. We have blocks we want to translate, we have contact forms, we have field labels, we have select lists, we have panels, we have strings, we have emails, we have variables, we have views. What else is there? There's a lot. For all that, we use IETN. So IETN is that whole suite of a lot of different translation systems, and that's IETN will help you to translate all these things. So even though we don't use IETN for like taxonomy terms and other stuff, we still use IETN for all these things because it works and it's the right system to do it. There's one important thing in IETN. If you just download it and you enable all the modules, because there are a lot, so let's just enable all the modules, like we all do that, you know, like all, sometimes you just go through and like, yeah, I need all of them. Don't enable the multilingual select. Because multilingual select is an idea that, who had heard the concept of query tags in Drupal? So in Drupal, you can inject like additional filters to all queries that is used like for node access to prevent that nobody can see stuff. And multilingual select does that, and it automatically injects a language filter for the language that you're currently on. So it tries you to give you like automatic like some help. The problem is it completely confuses people and or like editors, because like if you have like entity references, you cannot reference the nodes because the lang codes are not correct and stuff. You can configure it, but that's the default, the configuration. So it automatically assumes that it should start to filter some DB selects, and that's like we had crazy issues with just not enabling the module. You have no problem at all. Just don't do that. If you do it, know what you're doing, so it's all good. Language fallbacks. So, as you saw at the beginning, we have only one node, and Drupal just tries to load the different languages, or tries to load the languages for the fields. You can do language fallbacks. So Drupal can say, if I don't find a translation for German in the same node, I have English, or maybe I have Spanish, or maybe I have French. So I can just show that to the user. Because you saw in Switzerland before, everybody speaks at least two languages. So if we don't have it in German, I can show it in French. Maybe not the best solution, but I can do that. I should rather show it probably in English, because that's what more people speak, but it is possible. So the problem is, though, you cannot define the order of these fallbacks, because Drupal core itself doesn't have a UI. It has an API for it, but it doesn't have a UI for it. So language fallback module allows you to select the order of stuff. So you can say, if the German doesn't exist, load me the French and then the English. If the English doesn't exist, load me the Spanish and then that. So you can define the order, and it works really well. And you can like build websites where the content is only created first in English, and then slowly on the website it's translated to other stuff. And it also works for strings, so it's not only for entity stuff. There is a patch on there that you can use, and then you can also have language fallbacks on strings. So if you don't have translated, let's say, your web form, it will also check for other translations that are maybe existing. And on our GitHub repository, because the patch is not in there yet, so if you just want to use it, you can go there and stare. TMGMT, we'll see that later a bit. So it basically allows you to manage translation. It gives you a better overview of your languages. It puts all the translation stuff in one place, and it has plugins for external services. So if you have like an external translation provider, you can send them translations and come back. Drupal 8. There were a lot of people working on it, and we'll go into that deeper. But basically, there is no content translation like Drupal 7 anymore. That's out. The problem is, though, the entity translation module is called content translation. Yes. The reason is pretty easy. We asked people, what do they understand with entity translation? And we asked people, what do they understand with content translation? And we realized that content translation is the right name for it. Nobody understands entity. Everybody understands content. So therefore, we call it content translation, because that's when the people are on the module list, they know I need to translate content, so they enable the content translation module. They wouldn't click on the entity. So it's not content translation of Drupal 7, it's entity translation of Drupal 7, it's Drupal 8 content translation. So yes, it's confusing, but it works and it's really cool. And the best is, everything is translatable out of the box. So there's no additional modules necessary. You just download Drupal 8, you enable the modules, and it's all there. And now you know why we build so many sites in Drupal 8, because it's so much better. So, are there any questions about the stuff I talked now? Because the second part will go deeper into Drupal 8, what exactly has changed and what the modules are doing. But are there any questions for that part right now? Like, what should I do translatable? Why that module? Why not? Yes. So, yeah, so the problem that he describes is that with the menu translation, you have three different options. And if you select the first option, the options for the other possibilities are sometimes still shown. So you, if you don't know the internals of it, you can create systems that are broken by configuration that is done by a person. There is no fix in 7 that I know right now. We've implemented some easy form alters to just remove that stuff, but I don't know if there's any module that provides you do that. Talking about Drupal 8, it's not done yet. So if you want, we can sit together tomorrow and do it. We try, there's a lot of usability reviews on the multilingual that happens a lot, so we have people trying out and testing it and saying like, that's completely confusing, that doesn't make sense, and then people try to fix it. It's sometimes really hard to do that, but I agree, the user experience or the site builder experience is sometimes really bad in multilingual. So if you have time, at least write them down, create issues for Drupal 8. We have quite some time to work on still, and maybe somebody will actually fix it, or fix it yourself. But it is definitely a problem, and I cannot tell you module to go to fix it. Other questions? Okay, let's go into Drupal 8. Drupal 8, of course, we only talk about multilingual, or that's what my speak now will be about, but there is so much other stuff on Drupal that we, or when we started to talk about multilingual in Drupal 8, like I remember Drupal, where was that? Like basically when 4 or 5 years ago when we talked about, okay, let's do Drupal 8 multilingual, right. We all thought, okay, that's just like our little team and we can do that. And then suddenly you realize, oh wait, there's a new configuration management, you need to translate that, we have views, we have services that also need language. So the other initiatives, I wouldn't say they hate us, but a lot of times when they bring something up, then the multilingual team comes in and says, is it multilingual? And it's not, so then we have to change it a lot. So maybe one of the reasons that Drupal 8 is delayed is also multilingual, maybe. It's hard to say, maybe it is, but it's really hard to do multilingual right and correct through such a big system as we have with Drupal 8, but it works pretty well. So there is a saying that Drupal 8 core is more multilingual than Drupal 7 with all of contrib. So if you would download Drupal 7 and install all contrib modules, you could still not translate Drupal so deep than Drupal core without any contrib modules. That was our goal, and I think we pretty much achieved it. So just for a short wrap up, so basically if you want to have Drupal 7 multilingual, you have a locale module, you have an update module that downloads automatic translations from the localized Drupal.org, you have some content translation that we all know, then you like install all the IETN, you use all the variables because you also need to translate variables. Then you realize, oh, entity translation is actually better, so you do that. If you install all the modules on our Drupal 7 side, we are between 25 to 32 modules that are installed that are completely only to do provide translations. And yes, that's pretty bad. So we looked at that, and we said in Drupal 8, we want to do it all out of core, but we still don't want to put all in one single module, because some sites do not need that, so we actually came up with four different modules. So, but if we say we, or me, it's actually all these people. There's a lot of people that helped in actually doing multilingual Drupal 8 that it is right now. So there's a lot of people that helped, that spent endless hours of fixing it, of working on it, and working with other initiatives. So credit to them, because it's so great. So in general, it's more than 1,150 people contributed. And we don't count just commits, we count everything of like writing a comment, testing, helping out, uploading a screenshot, everything. So, and that's some, so we actually have, we do a lot of stuff in sprints. So, and it's a lot of fun. So we hang out, we discuss. That's Plutch. He is the builder of entity translation. That was like the last fixing bugs of entity translation to get them into core in like Badcamp 2013, I guess. We talk a lot, we have a lot of fun. So it's not only like hacking core in single dark rooms, it's a lot of team effort that we work together. Yes, so we fixed more than 1,300 issues in multilingual. That's a lot. So we maybe thought at the beginning, well, there will be like 200 issues and we'll be done. Yeah, well, as you know, things go longer. But yes, I talked about four modules. So the first one is language. The language module just basically tells Drupal that there is a concept of language. It doesn't provide you any translations yet or whatever. So if you need then a language in a Drupal site and no translations, you just install that. So it does that. Then we have the interface language. So everything that is provided on the interface, that is basically the T functions, they will be translated with the interface module. Then we have the content translation, or before entity translation module, and that's everything about an entity. And then we have a new thing in Drupal 8, which is called config, and we also have to translate configs, and that is provided by the config module. So what we basically did, we took these 29 modules, we decided what has to go where, and we created four modules, and they are there now. And if you install all of them, you can translate everything. So let's look into the modules specifically a bit deeper. Language. First, and I think there's no bigger bold move than actually asking the user for the first question when he installs, we ask him, in which language would you like to do that? And you can create a super specific one. So in that example, we select, I don't know, it's some, maybe somebody knows, but we have a lot of languages there. So you can select one, and what will happen now, it will connect to Drupal.org and download the translations already for the installer. So the installer will be now already translating. The stuff that is not translated is just because it's not done yet. Basically, everything will be translated. And there's even better, actually, that's a right to left. So after now, Drupal realized that it's a right to left, and now the installer is in the right to left. So it's almost not possible to make it easier. There are really interesting bugs now there, but that's just because it's not translated yet. So this will be all translated and all will be done. And so I think that's really great because people that cannot speak English can now install Drupal. Because we will also, based on the browser language, we suggest him the language. So if you only speak Chinese and if you download Drupal and install it, the first step will show you Chinese in your native language. And you basically have to figure out that you have to click a blue button somewhere. And after that, everything will be Chinese, which is, I think, really great to not have any barriers there. And of course, we need to have language assignments. So you can assign now languages to everything in Drupal. We already know stuff from Drupal 7 of nodes and user aliases. That was there already. But now we have taxonomy terms. We have views, so you can create language-aware views. We have site information. You maybe don't see the language selector all the time there, but it's basically everything now in Drupal has language assignments because they contain text. So you need to know in which language the text is. It's pretty easy. We have a super flexible language setup. So whenever you want to make stuff language aware, you just go on that content language page that now combines everything together, and you can define per content type. Because in 7, when you have 10 different content types and you need to change like the language for all of them, you have to click through 10 different content types. And here, you can just go there and you can say, okay, I want to for content, I want to show the language selector. For blogs, I don't. Basic blogs should be defaulted in English. My forum should not have a language. So you have one dashboard that you can configure all the translation stuff. And it makes it much easier to all first view how the site is configured and second to actually change something based on it. We have a lot of language visibility. So blocks can now be automatically shown out of the box based on language. So you can say, show me that block or not. Views are already language filtering, so you don't have to worry about that. And because we have views, everything in core now, all the stuff that you can do with views, you can just change. So if you want to show an English translator only the English notes, you can do that, because you can just change the configuration of the admin content view, whatever you want. Language selection has also changed a bit. So in the past, it was some strange because like you had to configure different things. Now you just say, okay, I wanna have a URL, I can configure it, I can change the URLs directly in there. That used to be in the language creation in Drupal 7. It was really confusing, now it's at one place. It's much easier. You can define what you want. A really big ask thing is for the browser. So we still have session and user, but for the browser settings, you can now directly in there configure the language mappings. So if you created a super special language code and you want to map that to a browser language, you can do that right now. Used to be a Drupal 7 module for that. It's now in core. You can add custom mappings if you need to. So it's just like all the things that you usually need on a Drupal 7 site. We have administration pages, so you can create a specific language for admin pages. Was also a module in Drupal 7. And you can change the last language that will be used. In Drupal 7, that's fixed to the site default language. You should never change the site default language in a Drupal 7 page, because you can break a lot of things. Now you can just say which is the last language, so it's pretty easy. So we worked a lot on here. Name transliteration, if you enter English, it's pretty obvious that we say articles here, that's easy, but let's say we have another language and somebody writes in special stuff and it has to be a machine readable name, so no special chars, so whatever you're gonna enter there, it will automatically translate it. That works with Russian as well. So it's all different languages. Whatever you paste in there, it will generate you a nice machine name that can actually be read by the system. So no worries of having translating stuff or whatever. It's also a Drupal 7 module. It's in core now, all done. A really big step Because who thought about that we maybe need websites without English? Well, we have them. So if you actually choose to install Drupal without English in the installer, English will never be installed because you choose to not to. If you do it, you can just remove it again. I mean, it's just a language. Why should you not be able to remove it? Drupal 7 forces you to have an English on there all the time. In Drupal 7, you delete it. Drupal 8, you delete it. It's gone. So to wrap that up, first of all, you can delete English. English, everybody likes that. We have much more flexible selections in languages. We have block visibility. We have views. We have configs. We have assignments to everything. And we are the first one in installer. That's all provided by the language module, the first one of four modules. Let's look to the second one, the interface translation. First of all, Drupal will automatically download translations from localized Drupal.org. So no unnecessariness of installing a module that does that. It does it automatically. If you have your own translation provider, like your own localized Drupal.org server, you can do that because maybe you're a really, really big company that have their own translations. So that all works. And it's all there. It happens automatically on cron. The cron will not run out because you memory limits. That happens all the time. So that is all fixed. And we also can track customizations. So let's say you download the translation for Hungarian here from localized Drupal.org. And you decide, no, I need to change some things. The next time it tells you there's an update from localized Drupal.org, it will download it again and override it. No, the module will track customizations. It will realize that whenever you change something that was not from localized Drupal.org, there will be a small flag in the database say that is customized, and the next time it will be updated, it will be not overwritten. Really easy. Somebody has to do it. We did it. So it's pretty well, and it allows you to just do whatever you need to. We have a completely new interface of translations. In the past, in Drupal 7, you had to click a lot. Now it happens in place. So let's say I want to translate at count. And you see on the left side, there's the source. On the right side, I can just directly translate it. So there's no need to click edit and then edit and save. And I'm not there when I used to be. You just change it. It can actually handle singular and plural. And one of the funny thing is there are languages in this world, they have 9 different plural forms. I just thought there are 2, there's singular and plural. That's what I grew up with, but apparently, so there it will actually show you 9 different plural forms, and it works. So yes, you can also search only for customized translations, so you can check which one did I change myself that were not downloaded from localized Drupal.org. So it's just much easier of translating all the stuff. We did accessibility checks on that. We fixed it for people that like use screen readers and all these things. So we did almost everything we could here. You can translate to English. So no need to create a second English anymore. But it is disabled by default because of performance. So if you want to do that, you just go to the language list. And you see here, it tells you interface translation not applicable. So you just go and edit. There is a button, enable. You enable it. And now you can translate it. It will make your website a tiny little bit slower when you do that. Because it will actually, the T function will now check. But now you can do the login to sign in an English without problems. So it's pretty easy, no need for a second language or all the craziness. So on my site, I have now, on my English, I have now sign in instead of login, which is the default by Drupal 8. So that's all the cool stuff that interface translation brings you. We can translate to English, we have a new interface to translate things, we track customizations, there is a centralized file directory. If you want to upload PO files, you all put them in one file. We auto-download new stuff, and it's a separate module. So if you don't need interface translations, if you only need content translation, you just install content translation. So it's completely separate. So content translation, we already looked at that a bit. So it's the entity translation of Drupal 7. It supports everything. Whatever is an entity, everything. But what is actually a content entity? Because there is config entities and there is content entities. Basically, content entities is everything that your site editors will write stuff in. So we have the whole bucket of entities in Drupal 8, and in there we have content entities. These are like notes, comments, contact messages, users, taxonomy terms, menu items, everything your editor goes in and adds text. So not your programmer and not your site builder. These are different. And again, when we saw before, I told you have to like enable translatability per field. We have websites with 180 fields. If you need to change something there, it's pretty heavy because you basically need to click like 180 times five times to change something. So you click a lot. So we said, hey, let's do it all in one place. So in the page that we saw before, it not only says, it shows you also all the fields. So if I make one of the content types translatable, it shows me all the fields that are on that content type, and I can say, do I need to enable translatability for them? And you see here, the file is not translatable, but the alt text and the title. So we even go into subfield levels, like the alt and the title is like a subfield something-ish. So you can do that, you can translate block bodies, whatever you can imagine you want to translate, you can do. And you change it, you save it, and it will be automatically all saved. No need for clicking around like crazy anymore. Of the translation interface, we try to change as less as possible. Because that's where the editors, they're used to Drupal 7. So it should be as much as possible the same as within Drupal 8. So everywhere that you have an edit tab, you also have a translate or a translations tab, and you can directly put it there. And it's like all the same things we know from Drupal 7. So on the translations, we see all the different languages that there exist, which one have already been created, what is their status, are they published or not, whatever. So it should be pretty easy. And the edit form itself, it just looks the same with different languages. So like in Drupal 7. So the people that are used to Drupal 7 translation, it won't be a big change to go to Drupal 8. Upgrading. As you might know, we decided that we will have migrate module in core, and of course we also have to migrate, and there will actually be also a migrate path from content translation to entity translation. Yes? Yes. Wait, I can't understand you. Yes.
If you have a default language, for example, different from the English, you click on the edit button, you've got the normal look of the form, and you are filling the text for the default language or for the English still.
Sorry. So on the content translation, content language form that you saw before, you can select which language should be the default language. So if you would like, if your default language in Drupal is, let's say, Hungarian, but the node article should be created in English all the time, you can select that. And you can also select if the editor should see the language dropdown or not. Okay, migration, yes. So we will not have an upgrade path, we will have a migration path, so you probably set up a new Drupal 8 and you point it to the Drupal 7 and it will migrate everything over. And it will obviously also support translation, so we'll also support that. It's right now we're working on it. Drupal 6 to 8 works already, Drupal 7 to 8 is really close to be finished. We have a search in Drupal core, it has now language support, so when you search in Drupal, it will automatically give you the right languages. The same actually for node access, so you can have node access per language. You can say like you cannot access Hungarian, but you can access German and not English because you don't have that role or whatever. You can do whatever you like to do. So that's all about the content translation. It's pretty obvious. We have node access, search indexes, we have search APIs. It works everywhere. We have it per bundle, field, and subfield. We saw that with the image. Properties are almost done. There are some little nitty-gritty things. And we have a migration path that works between the two different, with the old sites and the new sites. The new kit in the block, config translation or configuration management. Of course, let's say a views header, you enter a name in there, it's a config, you have to translate it, it's text. So, but what is the actual difference? So in content, I said, it's everything that the editor enters. So these are content. And then we have configuration, and configuration entities are like views, the vocabularies, the contact categories, or the fields. These are all configuration, and we also need to translate them. There are some things on the right side that are not entities, unfortunately, like a site info or the user mails. They are not entities. So we also have to support them. So that's why the configuration translation can also do them, even though they're not real config entities. Nothing you have to worry about. Made our lives a bit harder, but we like hard stuff. So, and there's some special things that we don't know how we do that right now. So it's path aliases. As said, it's not completely done yet, but we're working on it. For the configuration, it's actually saved in files. So if you have a language, it just creates a config file or a YAML file, how configuration is saved for that language. So it's super easy to work with. And the only thing that the language actually does, it just saves an override of the original one. So configuration management in itself has an override system, and language or config translation just leverages that. So it just basically overrides the normal configuration with the language, and it's all done and works pretty well. And it works for any configuration on the site. Let's look at an example. So I have my language switcher, and I can add in a Hungarian language, and I can just, I saw a translate tab, and I change it. It shows me the English one, that is the default. I change it, I save it, I go back to the site, and it's now translated on the left side. And now I want to translate my title, and I just go there. I have a tab, it's called Translate. I add the Hungarian, I translate it, and I go back to the site, and it's automatically there. So it's super easy. It's like where you actually enter the stuff, there is also a translate tab. So I think there is no easier way of doing translation than where they actually already appear. So I can switch between my English and the Hungarian. So it's all there. So the configuration is basically for whatever you have. It's its own module. You can, if you don't need it, you don't have to enable it. It shows you translation tabs. It has configuration overrides that it uses. It works for anything, and it works also for the shipped configuration. So everything that Drupal already comes with can automatically be translated. So we have four modules: the language module, the interface module, the content module, and the config module, that replaces all these 29 modules, and it comes out of the box, and you can use it today already. There is one part missing, though. We heard it before. It's about translation management. So we can maybe translate a lot of stuff in Drupal, and it's great, but there is no overview of which nodes are already translated, which taxonomy terms are translated. Who is right now working on translation? I want to send my translation to a translation agency that maybe speaks a language that I don't speak. And all these things, they're not handled by core. So in place comes TMGMT or translation management tools. So it's a module that already exists for Drupal 7 and 8. And it allows you to manage everything. And it gives you really nice overviews of your nodes. So you see here, I have three nodes, and I see I have two languages on my site, the English and the German. And I see in English, it's white, so it's the source language. And on the right side, I see the gray, which means it's not translated, but it's ready for review. So somebody translated that, and it comes back, and I can go and I can look at it, and I can say, it's good, and I accept it. On the second note, you see on the German, it's blue, so it means it's in progress, so somebody is working on translating that right now. So if they're gonna change it, I probably have to inform that person, for example, if that is maybe the workflow or whatever. So it gives you the possibilities to know what is the current status, what happened, what is not translated yet. You also have translation outdated. So let's say you accept that third note or Dritter note, you accept that and then you change the English. It will automatically mark the Germans as outdated. So you have to send it again or you translate it again. So it gives you all of that. And not only for notes, it gives you that for everything you can translate. So for all menu items, for all configurations, everything, it will show you in one place how the status is. So if you need translation management, use translation management tools. It already works for 8. We use it on everyday base. But we're not done with Drupal 8. It's not done. There is still some things going on. We are working on a lot of different things to fix stuff. And we need help. Or the faster we all want to have Drupal 8 out, we need help. If you like to help with multilingual, there is actually we have our own website. It's called drupal8multilingual.org. It gives you an overview of what are we working on right now, what are the issues, who is working on it, how to get involved. There's a list of cool Drupal 8 sites that are already out there in multilingual and stuff. There's a Twitter account, D8MI, that tells you about where new things happen. And if you cannot code, or you don't want to code, or you're afraid of, you shouldn't be, but let's say you are, but you still want to help, we need translations for Drupal 8 right now. So go to localize.drupal.org. If you speak any language in the world and you want to help translate, you just have to translate Drupal 8. So it's a nice interface that tells you all the stuff that is not translated, it's English, and you just translate it into your language. And you spend half an hour and you did something really great. Because the more we do that, the more languages, when the user come and select that language from the beginning, the better his experience will be to have an installer in this language. So you can send anybody you know. They don't need to know anything about Drupal. They just need to understand language and translate it. And it would help a lot, because right now is the right time to do it. We get really close to a Drupal 8 release, and therefore we just need the help of everybody. And as said, you don't need to understand PHP, no Twig, no whatever, just text and language. And if you want to try it out, go to simplytest.me and try it out. It's a super cool site that gives you now 24-hour access for a Drupal site. You just select Drupal and the newest beta, which is not 7 right now, it will be 12, I think, or right now it's 11, whatever. And you can try it out, play around. If you find a bug, if you find something you don't like, write an issue for it, tell everybody, so maybe somebody can fix it. Yes, so all that I talk now is all thanks to these people. More than 1,000 people that helped in getting it done and actually building Drupal 8, the best multilingual CMS that we've ever built. And I can tell you, we're looking at other CMSs out there, proprietary and open source, and nobody has what we have right now. Having a system that is out of the box, fully multilingual for everything, is not something that anybody else has. And all these people helped, and you can be one of them. So I invite you to help us and do things. That's it.